I messed up big time. There's no way this 24-pin chip is going to work on a pad that only has 20 pins. How did I get this so wrong? I've been working on my jumbo 7-segment display. One of the issues with version 1 is that the main PCB is really big, which means it costs quite a lot to manufacture. I've been working on a modular version of this with PCBs that can be daisy-chained together. This would let me have a lot of digits in my display and be very cost-effective. The boards are based around the TPIC6595. This is a really cool device. It's a shift register with open drain outputs that can sink a large amount of current. This makes them ideal for switching a large number of high power LEDs. So what actually went wrong? There is nothing wrong with the schematic. I'm using the TPIC6595 and this is the correct symbol. We can also check on the datasheet and we have all the pins correctly labelled. Well, it turns out these chips are actually quite hard to get hold of in a surface mount package. On Mouser, there's no stock until November, and on RS, it doesn't even show up in SMD format. Now, there is a variant of the TPIC6595, a TPIC6A95, that has the same functionality and seems to be more widely available. This chip actually has a higher current rating. In hindsight, I should have probably used this version in the first place, as the higher current rating means my LEDs could be much brighter. Somehow, during ordering, I managed to confuse this version of the chip with the TPIC6595. Unfortunately for me, it has a completely different number of pins and pinout from the TPIC6595. There is a 20-pin version, according to the datasheet, but it still wouldn't have worked as the pins are different. In some ways, I'm quite glad that I ordered the 24-pin version, as I would have quite happily soldered up the 20-pin version and then spent ages trying to troubleshoot why it didn't work. Somewhat annoyingly, I didn't notice my mistake until I'd already added solder paste and placed a bunch of components. Now, at this point, I must apologise to anyone with OCD for my haphazard resistor orientation. Normally, I would be more careful, but I got a bit overexcited about trying out my MHP30 mini hotplate. I promised to be more careful next time. It was only when I tried to put the chip on the board that I realised something was very wrong. I've been hunting around trying to find a supply of the SMD version of the TPIC6595, and I've not had much luck. I guess this is all part of the global chip shortage, so since I already have them in my hands and I've paid for them, I'm switching my design over to the TPIC6A595. As always, the PCBs came from PCBWay and they did a great job. Fortunately, I ordered some other boards that don't have any problems, so I'll be kicking off some new project videos soon, so don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell. Fixing things is pretty simple. There's no symbol in KiCad for this chip, so I ended up duplicating the existing symbol for the TPIC6595 and updating it to match the datasheet for the TPIC6A595. There are 4 more power ground pins to fit in, so we just need to make the symbol a bit larger. In hindsight, I could have just put all the pins on top of each other and kept the symbol the same size. Updating the schematic is pretty painless. We just need to shuffle things around a bit to make more space. Everything else stays exactly the same. Laying out the PCB is also quite straightforward. I had a reasonable amount of space to play with, so the longer chips fit without any problem, and we just need to route the traces again. Following the advice of one of my fellow YouTubers, this time I've printed out the PCB at 1:1 scale and I've confirmed that the chip actually fits on the pad. It's an annoying mistake to make. I had 2 different boards manufactured using this chip and made the fatal mistake of doing a copy and paste, so the error propagated across to both of them. But since I have some boards that I can't really use, I thought I'd do some experimenting and learn something new. I've seen a few of the cooler kids on YouTube using a vacuum cleaner to hold their solder stencil over the PCB, and I really wanted to give this a go. I've created my own version. The vacuum cleaner attaches to this adapter and the PCB drops into this slot. We just need to align the stencil over the top of the PCB and make sure all the pads are aligned with the stencil holes. I can then use my foot to switch on the vacuum cleaner. This holds the stencil really firmly against the PCB, so there's no danger of any gaps. It's really well stuck on, and you can't move it at all. We can now just spread the solder paste over the stencil. I'm not entirely sure I'm using the right tool for the job here. Any suggestions in the comments, and I think I need a bit more practice. At the moment it feels like my technique is a bit poor, but I think it will improve over time. With that done, we just need to turn off the vacuum and we can lift the stencil mask up. Doing a quick check under the microscope, it doesn't look too bad. I didn't have things perfectly lined up, and I think I smudged things a bit when I lifted off the stencil. I've seen a more sophisticated version that has springs to lift the stencil up when the vacuum is released. Maybe I'll try it out. Adding the components is a bit fiddly, especially when your hands are not very steady. Maybe a DIY pick and place machine should be added to the list of projects. Or maybe I just need to make sure I've had breakfast before trying to do fiddly work. Let's try out the MHP30 Mini Hotplate. This is a lot smaller than I was expecting, but the board does balance nicely on it. I'm going to heat the board up to 220 degrees and see what happens. It works really well. I love watching the components move into position. It's quite mesmerising. The MHP30 is pretty small, but you can shuffle the PCB around to get all the components soldered. One word of caution, the PCB does get hot, so don't use your fingers to move it around. Yeah. Looking at the results under the microscope, we've got some good results. I can see a few solderables along the sides of the resistors, but these come off very easily when we clean the board with some IPA and a soft brush. Looking at the side view of some of the resistors, I think this looks great. It's certainly not as good as a reflow oven, but for my little projects, I think it will do the job. I'll be using this for a few projects, and I think as I gain more experience, my SMD assembly will improve dramatically. It's definitely better than my attempts at SMD hand soldering, which you can watch in this video coming up now. So, quick update. I have managed to score some of the SMD TPIC6595 chips on eBay. I've no idea if they will actually work, but I'll give it a go. I'm going to have a lot of these modular boards to play with. I'm sure I'll think of some good projects.